In 1996, the internet was probably introduced to one of the greatest web browsing players of all time, Macromedia Flash Player. Flash Player was open to letting us watch or play some of the best animated content displayed in the highest video quality, made by using Macromedia's animation software, Flash. Flash Player was extremely popular at the time, as most of the media were hosting Flash content for displays that normally wouldn't be achieved without it. Currently today, the branding on Flash and other software has changed from Macromedia to Adobe. Since 2005, the company Adobe Inc. bought Macromedia, owning everything they created, with Adobe continuing Flash's legacy instead. Adobe later renamed Flash to Adobe Animate in 2015, but never renamed Flash Player for some reason. Unfortunately, around 2017, Adobe stated that Flash Player would end support in December 31st, 2020, being removed from all browsers because of its declining popularity, meaning that all Flash-related content like games and cartoons would sadly die off the internet, which is extremely upsetting to happen. Reason why so many people stopped using Flash Player was because HTML5 was supposed to be the perfect replacement for it, as it works on mobile while Flash Player doesn't. You might wonder if anyone is trying to make a replacement for Flash Player. Two have, sorta. There is the Newgrounds player, but it's not the perfect replacement as it only works on Newgrounds and isn't an actual like browser extension. Also, the fact that it only works on Windows is not great. There's also Blue Maxima's Flashpoint, which is a web game preservation project that has currently archived over 36,000 Flash games and 2,300 animations, which could actually be perfect to archive everything. Oh. When Flash Player dies, this is what we probably have to live with, I think. Probably not, because isn't Flash Player just going away in general? Not just for browsers? It requires the program. Not even sure how you can stick. Either way, you should request as many Flash-related content as possible to be added to Flashpoint, before it's too late. So anyway, with Flash Player being close to its death, I thought about making a series where I use this free Flash decompiler to convert Swift files into FLA files, and showcase a bunch of unused graphics, animation, off-screen secrets, codenames, text strings, how certain things were animated, etc. I will also just explain about the games itself before decompiling one each. This is the first episode of a series that will most likely die when Flash Player does, but let's do it. You may have all heard about this internet show back in 2010, as right now it's the 10-year anniversary of it, that being Battle for Dream Island, or Bfdia for short, an extremely charming series created by twins Michael and Carrie Huang, with cartoon objects competing to win the prize of Dream Island, with almost every episode having a contestant leave the show, with inspiration coming from Toll Drama while that was inspired by Survivor. The show currently has 4 seasons, while the 4th season has the entire show split up into 2, and season 2 and 3 being incomplete. Go watch it, it's super good. But this series actually is a Flash game based off the 2nd season called Bfdia 5B. It's part of a 5-part series of episode 5 starting from 5A to 5E, with only the 2nd part, 5B, being a game instead of an actual episode. The game's a 2D puzzle platformer where you have to try to escape the body of this creature called Evil Leafy. And this game is just fantastic. The dialogue on the characters are really charming, the game looks visually nice and dark, the controls feel tight, and has some great mechanics. Plus, this background music right now is from the game. Overall, a really creative game that was sadly unfinished as it was put on a hiatus to finish Bfdia 5C and the rest of the parts. But that's when the main hiatus for the series started, when 5E finished, until it came back 3 years later as IDFB, then BFB. The Huang brothers did say in an update video in 2016 that 5B would possibly be finished, but did not end up happening. The game most likely won't finish now because of Flash Player dying, and it's a shame really, because I really would have loved to see what could have happened next. We just know that they escape. Now let's decompile the game. Sorry if you forgot what this video was about. We open up the file with just a loading screen with nothing else on the timeline, except for the action frames that pretty much load up the entire game. We can see the code for mechanics and UI, save progression code that also has a text file attached that has all the code for all the levels made along with number callouts for specific characters and objects. The reason why there's a separate file for levels to generate is not only because it's easier to make levels with, but it's to make sure that nobody else can steal the Swift file and host it on other websites, as without the text file, it's stuck on the loading screen forever. It's a neat little anti-piracy system, but it can easily be broken through, as you're able to download the Swift file and text file and put them in a folder together to make the game work. Now, did you know you can actually manipulate the code for the game and some changes can actually occur? There's 53 levels in the game, and only Book, Match, and Ice Cube are playable throughout, and never Pencil, Ruby, and Bowl are unlocked, due to the game being unfinished. But with code manipulation, you can play as them, along with the recommended characters that were supposed to be unplayable. Loading these unused characters have different stats. Ruby is heavy like Ice Cube, Tenzo can slightly jump higher than Match, but the character with the most interesting stats is probably Bubble, as she's able to jump the highest than anyone else, but pops easily when colliding with walls. Now with the recommended characters, Waffle's heavy and slow, Lego can jump high, same with Toon, but Toon interestingly has a carry and side view poses that went unused, which means he was probably going to be playable for the unadded custom level feature, which I'll get to soon. Or he was going to carry something in a level where you would probably have to kill him for it. One cool thing about playing characters you aren't supposed to is playing as the hazards in inanimate objects. This is so awesome! And this slime goop hazard is like the fastest character in the game and it's amazing. I definitely recommend experiencing the game this way instead of normal characters, it's really funny. One more thing before we move on, Waffle, can you do the honors? Yeah, thanks. And who could forget Lego's missing mouth? Let's go over a planned feature that never happened. The level creator. Ever wanted to access the option but couldn't? Within the game's files, simply codenamed level creator is the actual menu for the custom level editor that was never fully implemented. Quickly analyzing this, we have the tools at the bottom and the submenus on the side. For the tools at the bottom, pencils for drawing tiles, erasers for erasing tiles, plus the eraser tools icon is just erasers asset tinted, while the pencil graphic uses the base from pencils asset and not tinted. Shape tool for drawing multiple tiles at once, bucket tool to fill shapes, eyedropper tool that I'm not sure how it would work, selection tool, row and column tiles to create a row or a column of tiles, copy, undo, clear, you know what they were going to do. Part of this is just speculation, since I'm not even sure how most of these would have actually functioned. For how the item bars on the right would have worked, I think if you selected one of the categories, it would slide down the other categories underneath to display some menu of items. Literally something like TF2, as an example. All these categories display nothing except for the level info, showing we could write the level's name and description along with the person's name as creator. Oh hey, the recommended character still wouldn't be playable. Oh my god, level saved! Anyway, with the information earlier, I guess the plan was to make them playable, but later scrapped the idea. Now, the dialogue option sticks out the most, as it would've been a fun way to add a story in your own levels, but I think they would've been pre-made dialogue messages for obvious reasons. Another thing to talk about are these two unseen tiles in the game that have a function. This unique tile that says air on it is used to create any unfilled background space in the game's levels, and this other unique tile that says Dean between some brackets, which is supposed to be the dialogue trigger that you can place to let a character speak. These tiles were going to be usable in the level creator as their graphics are stored in a symbol called LE Tiles 2 and LE Tiles 3, respectively, with codenames for these symbols being mentioned for the level creator. LE Tiles actually stands for Level Editor Tiles. There's actually a ton of code for the level creator, but it's a bit hard to talk about since I know nothing about coding. But I found code for the grid. I don't know if it would actually display on the screen or if it just be invisible. There's a function fill tile for probably filling inside tiles with the bucket tool. Like, I'm already impressed if this actually would have worked. The level info tab and the level buttons text code has a function called texty. Alright. I think that's everything I could find that could be unused or hidden. I don't know, I'm not a C++ genius. Give me a break. Moving on to the option explore, it's a look for and download other people's levels. That's it, I literally thought this was a different mode back then. Despite the custom level editor not being added, you can still make custom levels by editing the game's levels text file. Looking at this is really cool, because you can recognize all the level layouts with this data. Now, it's hard to know how to even edit anything, which is why there's a paste bin for everything you need to know. Along with that is a chart that explains everything in detail, made by current Bfdia teapot showrunner Satomi. Like I said earlier, just make sure to put the text file and the Swift file together in a folder so you could be able to make custom levels. Looking into some backgrounds now, the ones that have this mountain graphic in it is actually hue shifted, with the original color for it being blue. It's the same mountain graphic from the show, just colored differently. Along with these trees reused from the show, just tinted. And that's everything to talk about the game before we move on to the next. Last thing I want to say is please try this game out. It's a very difficult, engaging game if I'm being honest. There's a freaking level with a companion cube from Portal that you can use in like 3 levels, then forced to say goodbye to it. It's sad. Next, we're talking about Fancy Pants Adventures, another 2D platformer we're talking about. This Flash game was created by Brad Bourne. It came out in 2006 with just one world, as two other worlds would be added later in 2008 and 2012 respectively. The main star of the game is a spiky-haired stick figure who wears orange pants named Fancy Pants Man. It's a 2D side-scroller that has a lot of cool parkour elements in its level design. I never really played these games when growing up, maybe once or twice. Playing it for this video was quite a lot of fun. It's a really solid short game, and the series gets better in later entries, so I recommend trying these games out, especially again to those who grew up. Moving on, we're now going to decompile the game. Starting off when opening the file, it's just a black screen that's nothing. But on the second frame is a black screen that has all the game assets inside. By the way, I'm mostly just going to talk about the 1.7 version of the game, with just a few mentions of the older version. In the very first frame of Fancy Pants Man, there's an early tutorial graphic of Fancy Pants Man going through a door that was hidden off screen, but was replaced in favor of this one. Let's look into Fancy Pants Man himself, who's wearing white pants instead of orange pants. Reason being that the pants are actually color-coded, because the game gives you three other color options for the pants. A really cool thing is that all the keyframes for Fancy Pants Man are all named after his actions, with my favorite being Null. What the fuck? This dude has like no hair anymore. And the code for this frame is not helpful at all. Maybe it was some sort of reset point for the character. For when he dies, I'm not sure. Fancy Pants Man actually has three unused animations. The first we'll quickly get out of the way. It's a leftover animation from the earlier version of the game of Fancy Pants Man opening a door, which is under a keyframe saying pull sword. It seems to be an unused function with an animation that doesn't even fit. There was a sword room in the original version of the game, but the pull sword function was still not used. The other unused animation is him getting up on his front, which is stored inside of his getting up symbol, and the animation is incredibly unfinished. And his last unused animation is him looking over the edge. Let's look into other symbols with named keyframes, like the swirly collectible in the game, which has a top keyframe in the end that says, "Don't cheat." The same frame the collectible disappears. Looking into all the actions for the penguin— Where's the penguin? Now looking into the penguin from the older version of the game has something interesting on the last frame. There's writing that says J00RTWinner111. Not sure what kind of placeholder this is. But it's the same frame where the penguin gets deleted when you defeat him. Also, this same frame is labeled explode, which probably meant the penguin was originally gonna explode, but I'm not sure. Also, here's a glimpse of all the keyframe labels for the penguin. Another thing I want to show is a template text that says this stuff. This symbol is used to display combo text for when you hit snail shells. In Fancy Pants, there's trophies to collect in the game of characters that are supposed to be based on popular Newgrounds members at the time. Looking at Rocky Pinnacle's trophy description in the older version of the game shows two older descriptions off-screen. There's differences, especially with the first lines. Part of Neptune's Circle, Rocky starred in the Kermit Combat series. Long before I had even touched Flash, the Kermit Combat series hit the internet. Long ago, before I had made any Flash to call my own, I stumbled upon the first Kermit Combat on Newgrounds. These unused descriptions were removed in later versions. Here's a really cool thing to look at. All of the collision strokes for the level geometry that you get to see for the first time. I should probably explain their specific functions first before I show anything else. The sine vectors are for wall jumping and grabbing on edges. The green vectors let the character stay attached to the ground if there's a round bump or a loop. Purple vectors are for platforms that you get through from the bottom. Yellow is to make the walls and platforms slippery. These red T-junctions prevent the camera from moving out of bounds. Anyway, here's what the rest of the levels look like. Seeing all this is super dope, I love it. Moving along, a few levels have a lot of things off screen, like a few graphics hiding in some color palettes. And these bonus sections and levels having random collision strokes and collectibles outside that seem to have a purpose. The linkage name for these symbols implies that, but these just could have been left over. The bonus sections do have a bunch of messed up assets on top of each other. This frame does not even show up at all in the game, and just takes collision from the first level. I think I should probably move on to the next game. Don't think you want to hear me talk about this green squiggly line with a door inside all day. But seriously, before we move on, I'm going to showcase all the linkage name for the symbols. I like how some of the names just say te platforms, te walls, spelled intentionally wrong. Just fun stuff. We're done with the first game, so now let's take a look at Fancy Pants Adventures 2. The gameplay is similar to the first with a few quality of life changes added to the core gameplay, and the world's being so much bigger and way more fun. Just like the last game, the entire game is set as one symbol again, but this time the graphic says everything. Looking into the main menu first, the game displays general control and menu options, but outside of that frame, it has an unused control option. T, toggle stopwatch, was originally there to set a time for yourself in levels, and probably the entire game as well. The function doesn't work at all, and I couldn't seem to find code for it. It's quite unfortunate that this got cut. Also, this graphic right here looks familiar, which is actually the same graphic that was unused from the first game. And the reason why it was stored in the first game was because that was the 1.7 version of the game that came out at the same time as the second game did. Anyway, looking through everything here has some levels displayed very oddly. Like, whatever this scrap section is, it displays a collision in the background from Tommy LM's level, and has some floating doors and collectibles. Probably an earlier version of the level, I think. Also, this green vector exists with no purpose. It appears a few times. Probably not as weird as this random circle outside of the final level. Let's talk about scrapped areas or bonus levels. Like this section from the final level of the game with a unique foreground. And there's these scrap bonus levels with messed up assets. The most interesting of all this is this scrap tutorial level, teaching wall jumps and ledge grabs. There's even a trophy you can collect by grabbing this edged wall. It also would have taught you to be able to push objects, as the tutorial text implies, which you cannot even do in the final game. Oh yeah, tutorial text! There's 4 frames of tutorial messages for the stage, detailing everything I said prior. The tutorial stage is supposed to have this box graphic, the object you were supposed to push. This level also has this unique graphic, which I'm sure is for the tutorial. The code name for this symbol is named Swift, and the code inside of it says something about Swift count. Now, I sadly didn't know how to get this level to work, along with the other scrap ones. Now looking inside the first level's backgrounds, show to be blurred and have color palettes on the side. Plus the set piece is on top of another set piece with this background. I also found a few more hidden or unused graphics like this green swirly thing. A few more hidden color palettes. This bush graphic that appears outside of stages. A red snail shell. Unused animations of fencing men grabbing a ledge wobbling side to side with no hair added. An animation of him looking over the edge, which was already unused before. 2 unused animations inside his flying symbol are unused. Plus this section here between frame 53 and 65 has this animation that's semi-unused. All the poses are repurposed starting from frame 66 to make him rotate faster, then into a still pose. Perhaps one of the most impressive things in the second game is a section where you have to go up this loop-de-loop. You probably wonder how this even works. It's this green ball outside that draws collision strokes to certain parts of the loop, and it's insanely the coolest thing. Let's take a look at all the guest levels, like all the backgrounds for them, including backgrounds from Luis's and Negative One's levels that were converted to bitmaps, probably done for optimization reasons. There's oddly another background hidden behind the main background in Negative One's level that was used in Afro Ninja's level. My favorite background out of all these is from Adam Phillips, which is the actual level. You're playing on a background that's pretty much a foreground. The real background is just the sky. But overall, this is a stunning piece, and you never get to see it all at once. Looking into the credits room, there's actually a different message off-screen directed to Jenna Gala. Also this random unused wall here, which has an earlier pattern compared to the final one that added more detail. That's enough with the second game, it's time we move on to the third game! Oh, never mind, this game has a protection system, and for good reason too. So maybe this video was not a good idea, I guess? And also, I don't want to make this video too long at all. But anyway, play all the Fancy Pants games, including Super Fancy Pants Adventures, which is on Steam. Recently, Brad Bourne remastered the first Fancy Pants game that's available right now in iOS and Android. One more thing, I'm probably gonna cover the Fancy Pants Adventures World 1 remix in another video. Or not, as I can't get all the action script code in the FLA I'm converting. I was only lucky with the 2 other games. Plus the game wasn't put as one symbol. Just looking through the library is a nightmare alone, but I did find something. Hidden is a symbol called a ground smoke that has broken ground parts from the 3rd level and some green vectors. This symbol right here has this on the 11th frame.
What the fuck?
Yeah, I tried my best to see if I could find it in game, but I couldn't. But I think the evil pencil was supposed to draw it, which is fucking cruel! Moving on, we're now looking at the Riddle School series, a click and point adventure game. It came out in 2006 and was created by Jonochrome, formerly known as JonBro. The game is about a school student named Phil who tries to get out of school because he gets detention. Motherfucker deserved it. Now, I sadly never played these games when growing up. The only click and point adventure games I played were just SpongeBob. And I somehow never completed them. Anyway, Riddle School is a really charming series. The 3rd game is probably my favorite out of all of them. Decompiling the 1st game, there's nothing to really talk about except for these 4 static images stacked together, and this water liquid animation that are both outside the entire game. The liquid animation is used for this tap in the hallway section. Don't know about the stacked static images. There's an unused locker off screen that's gray instead of blue. Random lines? Jesus Christ, document this already. Onto Riddle School 2, there's an unused graphic that says Secret Frame 1 and 2. And there's multiple of them for some reason. There's also this, but this could be a cut background element. There's actually nothing with the 2nd game. Let's move on to the 3rd. The 3rd game brings back Secret Frame 1 and 2. Okay. I'm definitely missing something here if they're important, but their only code is just stop, so it's really nothing. Here's something uncommon in Flash games, unused dialogue. The dialogue for that scene was originally different compared to the final. There's also a lot of unseen early sketches for rooms like Teacher's Lounge, Supply Closet, Lunch Room, and other rooms. Some with no specific detail. The walls in the Teacher's Lounge sketch is cyan, while the final color is dark blue. For how this game stores cutscenes in the game, they're stored inside these black boxes hidden on top of the screen's left corner, and some interesting alternative ways they're stored in. The part where you clog the toilet and the janitor comes in has him behind a stall after, and removing that stall reveals that he's not fully drawn, as you're not meant to fully see him. Now, I thought this was everything in the game until I looked in the 36th frame and found full written plans for the entire game, only there to remind the creator on what to do. Some plans were marked done, but not all of them were marked that, even though they were done. Everything mentioned here was in the final game, with this list just being slightly outdated. This list actually has some character to it, like the plan adding dialogue to the lunchroom, but maybe have Greg be woken up, only to just say no after. So weird, because you aren't supposed to see this. Another cool thing is on the last frame, it contains early credits for the game that's generally just the same but mentions other credit roles, and credits Nintendo for only just listening to music while programming. Sure. That specific text is highlighted differently though, probably showing that I wasn't gonna make it in the final credits. Now on to the fourth game! It's a troll game. Riddle School 4 was originally meant to be an actual game, but was short-lived and resorted as a troll game. This game is like the Rayman 4 click-and-point adventure games. Both were supposed to be the fourth game for their respective series, but got resorted to something else. In the only room of the game, this classroom has a broken tile that has an animation that was not enabled. And underneath the tile is a grate, which John mentioned on the commentary video on his game. This game had some major changes before the game was a troll. The inventory would have been expanded via option. The inventory menu originally had a feature to combine items together. The button to combine has keyframes that say combine two items and just combine. Don't know what the difference would have been. This box here has a text box with nothing on it, but I think it was there to identify the objects or given descriptions if your cursor were over them. Just speculation. Now in the second frame for that box has a set to drag your items into to combine. One more thing the inventory menu has is a bunch of icons for the items you would have picked up, like a paperclip, a pencil, and string, with icons of them combined together. There is even this notebook in the game where you can write your own notes for the puzzles, which is great to use instead of a notepad document, but you can only save those notes by finding save stations. That would have been pointless. Another discovery that I made is that there's a map menu, which could have been a zoomed in map, but this map design is extremely different compared to the one in the final game. I'm not entirely sure which would have been the real map for the game, but it seems that the initial plan was to make Phil go through building to building. Also, I keep thinking this one building is just a middle finger, but I think it's telling me to fuck off and move on to the next game already. Riddle School 5! Starting off, I found this blue stroke outside of this tutorial menu. Another discovery I found was the characters' names outside of their respective rooms. You probably wondered in this plant room how this energy ball effect works. Defect used masking for the spin rotation of the ball, with a ton of blur effects enabled. And that's everything to talk about in this video. A weirder way to end it, but it's pretty long. Make sure to check out the Riddle School games because they're real hidden gems. And one of Jonacrum's recent videos, Can't Food. I know I didn't talk about the Riddle School transfer games, but I'll talk about them in another video. If there's even going to be another episode. I planned this series for like months and didn't even get anywhere until now, but at least I did it. There's not much time left. I mean, I at least want to make 20 episodes, but like that's an impossible goal, and I'm not even sure how to make videos faster. The structure of these videos may change in the future until I can adjust the style. Anyway, that wraps it here. If you have any requests for me to cover any Flash games you want, I would say request in the comments, but please DM me on Twitter, because I'd rather have comments with genuine thought on the video. If you want to see future videos, you know what buttons to press.
Bye!